gang. Yes, that's what I'm talking about. Welcome, welcome, welcome to the Outlander Comic-Con panel. How pumped are we? I didn't hear you all. How pumped are we? I'm Lolo Ganaike. I'm a veteran journalist, and I'm host of Entertainment Weekly, the show. Thank you. Thank you. Yay. And I'm also a huge, huge, huge Outlander fan. Am I alone? No, I'm not. I love the acting. I love the sets. I love the books. I love the historical fiction. I love the whiskey. I love the kilts. I love the love scenes. I love the whiskey. I love the love scenes. My husband's out of town, so you know, I've been watching a lot of Outlander. Whew. In fact, I watched a few episodes of season four. Yep, I watched a few episodes of season four. Uh-huh, I've got the hookup. Yes, I do. And I can tell you it does not disappoint. It does not disappoint at all. It will blow your socks off. Yeah, and that's just the beginning. That's just the beginning. And speaking of beginning, the woman who started it all, Diana Gabaldon, please come to the stage. Up next, we have the extraordinary executive producer, Meryl Davis. Showrunner and EP, Ronald D. Moore, welcome to the stage. The debonair, Richard Rankin, please come to the stage. He's got the moves. All right.
I love you too!
He loves you too. We also love Sophie Skelton. Does our next guest even need an introduction? Sam Heughan, welcome to the stage. Now that's how you make an entrance. Thank you, Sam. And last, but certainly not least, the luminous, the magnificent, the stunning, the talented Katrina. Yeah. Bow. Welcome. Madison Square Garden!
What's up?
Oh my God.
That was Sam's Conor McGregor walk, by the way. That's not, nothing's happened to him in the last 2 hours. That's just.
My Conor.
I know I speak for everyone in the room when I say I am so happy the Droughtlander is over.
Yeah.
It's over. Let's get this party started. All right, Ron, it's not all rubies and sunshine in the colonies.
No.
No, it's not.
It's a slightly less happy place than you would think, yeah.
So last season, Jamie and Claire racked up some serious frequent travel miles. I mean, they were everywhere. They went to Boston, Scotland, the Caribbean, the high seas. And now in season four, they finally settled in North Carolina. Talk to me about the theme and the tone of season four, especially now that it gravitates around home and laying down roots.
Yeah, I mean, it really is the season when they finally decide to have a home, to have a place that they can call their own. And it's also, you know, it's the classic story of the of immigrants coming to the New World, in a wave of people that are coming in the 18th century, and Claire and Jamie are just two more of them, along with, you know, their family and friends that they bring with them to these shores. And it's a great retelling of sort of the American foundational myth. And, you know, as they come into North Carolina and then put down stakes and decide this is the place that they will call home.
Now, Meryl, you've called Outlander the traveling show because there hasn't been one season that's like the previous season. Last season, you moved production from Scotland to South Africa. Where do we find ourselves filming in real life in season 4?
We're filming in Scotland, of course, because hey. We love Scotland. We did talk about at one point trying to move to North Carolina because in the beginning of the series, Ron and I were so excited that we were actually shooting a show in the actual place it took place. And we thought, do we want to stay that? And Sophie always ruining everything. but ultimately, we decided we love Scotland, we love our crew, and that's really where we should be. And we realized that along with a little help from the art department and costume and locations that we thought we could pull it off. And huge kudos to our locations department. I mean, when you see eventually River Run and all of these places, they've done such a magnificent job of capturing North Carolina essence in Scotland. I've often said the only thing we can't do there is the weather, that we just can't capture that steamy North Carolina summer.
I heard there were some trips to Slovakia as well.
We did look at Slovakia for a while, and we were going to do some of the traveling shots there, but once again, Scotland
We're always happy to go on these trips.
We were like, Hawaii? Would Hawaii
no,
work?
No one
Hawaii.
Asked us.
It's very steamy, I believe.
Diane, I have to bring you in here. Season 4 is based on Drums of Autumn, the fourth book in your outstanding series.
That was thank you. Woo! Woo!
It's hard to believe that that book was published in 1996.
Yeah, It's been a while.
It's been a few decades.
I'm not sure Sophie was born yet.
No, I'm sure not.
I wasn't.
Were you?
I was born, I actually thought it was before that. I was born in 94, so just
made it.
So she was a grand total of 2 years old. Yep. What was it about that period back then that intrigued you? Why did you want to explore the colonies, pre-Revolutionary War? What was it about that era, 8 years before the Americas as we know it came to be? Why did you find that period such fertile creative ground for you?
Well, two things. It didn't really matter. It's the characters' lives. You know, the setting is not that important. But the first thing is that that's just what happened in history. Mm-hmm. People say, oh, I loved Scotland. Why doesn't the story stay in Scotland? And I said, well, yeah, everybody loves Scotland. You know, swords, tartans, whatnot. But that Scotland is gone. You know, it disappeared after Culloden. It wasn't there anymore. So the Scots had to go somewhere, and where a lot of them went was the New World. Some of them went up the coast to Prince Edward Island, Nova Scotia. A whole lot of them went up the Cape Fear River into the mountains there because it looked like home. Mm. And so I said, okay, that's where they went. And so the next question was, what's going on in the mountains then? And that was the War of the Regulation, which is just getting started. But if you stand back a little, and this is the second thing, you look at it, you can see this escalating tide of, you know, philosophy, enlightenment, and violence that leads straight from the Jacobite rising across the ocean and straight through the War of the Regulation into the American Revolution. At the time of the Revolution, one colonist out of every three was from Scotland.
Wow.
Now that's a fun fact. Thank you. The books have been wildly successful. I'm assuming they have completely changed your life. But how soon into the airing of the series did you know that the show would be the juggernaut that it is?
Pretty much from the first time I saw it. Mm. Yeah, I think I watched the first episode 4 times in a row when they showed it during Television Week in Los Angeles because I was, you know, just riveting. And I said, yeah, we got something going here. Okay. Yeah. By the way, I need to thank you and the audience. You all laughed at all of the lines from the book.
That's fantastic. Richard and Sophie.
Yes.
Yes. We really get to see more of Roger and Bree this season, which is a huge treat for us fans, isn't it?
A huge treat or about time.
In one extensive blog post about your character's union, a fan wrote, "Bree and Roger's relationship feels like my favorite pair of shoes. Cute, comfy, and timeless." What do you both...
Comfy.
Oh, comfy. Right?
Oh, you're like a pair of old boots.
Yeah. Or slippers.
I mean, just easy, not too fussy, just comfy.
How do you feel about being compared to comfy footwear, and what do you make of that assessment?
I kind of quite like it, but I almost feel like it would be more realistic if sort of the left shoe was killing your feet while the right one was comfy.
Oh.
Don't say that about yourself. Come on, it's not all bad, it's not
and
that bad.
And that's the problem, that is not a comfy shoe.
I feel like we're the old boots now.
True.
Speaking of comfy, it's clear that you all have a palpable chemistry. What is your dynamic like off camera? I see that you
we
guys like to rib each other.
Yeah, it's awful. It's awful. They separate trailers, not allowed to speak to each other.
Restraining order, actually.
Okay.
Yeah.
You could actually no eye contact.
That over. Thank you.
That's better.
Thanks very much. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, what can you tell us about the evolution of Roger and Bree's relationship? I know that they figure prominently in the books, but the television series is an entirely different beast. What can you share with us about season 4?
Well, I mean, obviously, with it being an adaptation of the books, there are going to be changes. There are going to be concessions made to certain scenes and the way those stories are told and adapted for the screen, either for logistical or storytelling purposes. But what I think our writers do a great job of is still, capturing, maintaining the essence, the kind of spirit of what the scenes were about. And I think that's what's so great about Roger and Brianna, certainly on season 4, is we get a good look at that, not only together, how they function together and how they really sort of bounce off each other or, you know, like... stress each other out, I suppose, at times, but also what they're like individually and what's going on for them, you know, as individuals, which obviously impacts them greatly when they're together.
Sophie?
Yeah, I mean, I feel like it follows the books quite closely in terms of the dynamics of their story and sort of certain scenes that you might be hoping to see from the book are in the
like
season.
What?
Like the
like bouncing off each other. Did you?
Don't know what you mean.
I picked up a bit.
Without ruining it, I will ask: is there travel in Bree's future?
Well, as you know, Bree is in Boston, and then she goes to MIT, and then she goes to Scotland. That's it, really.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, good. Nice good, good. Trips. Moving right along. Yeah. Sam and Katrina. Our favorite couple. They survived 20 years apart and a shipwreck. And judging from the first few episodes, their love is still strong. It's deep and it burns bright. That thrills me to no end. Sam, when Jamie says to Claire, "Even when my body dies, my soul will still be yours," I swooned. I'm not ashamed to say I shed a tear. I looked at my husband and said, "Why don't you say things like that to me?"
Because Diana Gabaldon's not writing his dialogue.
She certainly isn't, though he does need your help. We'll talk about that off stage. But talk to me about the evolution of this beautiful love story that spans decades in time and all sorts of boundaries. Talk to me about the evolution from season 3 to season 4. And what do you think the center thing is about their relationship that binds them together? Because they really are the definition of soulmates.
They've been through a lot, you know. We've been through 3 seasons and many experiences, and I think, you know, their relationship has evolved, and at the core of it is this great love and understanding. But yeah, they're soulmates, but they've been fighting to be together, and now finally this season they're allowed to be briefly together for a period of time, and it's what they've always wanted, and also find a home. And I think that's what Jamie certainly has always yearned for.
Yeah, I think after the 20-year separation,
And also Claire sort of making the ultimate sacrifice by leaving her daughter to go back to him once they kind of got over that initial getting to know each other period again. I think this season there's such a contentment with the two of them being together, and you finally get them, you see them enjoying, like, building a life together, building this home together, and it's a much more settled and content place than we've ever got to explore before. Obviously, it's Outlander, so there's always going to be external forces and many other things, but I don't think there's cliffhangers again about whether this couple will stay together or not. You know, that's pretty certain that they're solid.
We got this.
We got this.
We got this. All right, so they're telling me that we need to start the fan Q&A, but I have a quick game that I wanted to play with you all really quickly, we will get to the Q&A, I promise.
We like games.
I promise. Very it will not involve dancing, I promise. Last year at Comic-Con, you had to dance. Which,
no, that's a good thing, thank you.
Feel free.
We've just had boxing anyway.
Okay. Okay, so last year you played Truth or Dance with Jenna Dewan. I won't make you bust your moves today, I promise. But we are going to play a little game called Outlander, Outlandish, or Out of Bounds. So here are the rules. I'm going to make a statement, and you're going to tell me if it's true, a.k.a. Outlander, false, a.k.a. Outlandish, or Out of Bounds, which means it may be a little too close to a spoiler, or you just don't want to
go
there. Right, you got it. So we'll start with an easy one. Sam is the most likely to get drunk on whiskey off camera.
False.
Outlander, outlandish, or out of bounds?
I mean,
and feel free, anyone can chime
by.
In. Comparison to who? Because, I mean, Rondi Moore is sitting here. Diana Gabaldon is sitting here. Sophie Skelton is quite partial to the whiskey.
Thank you.
I've never taken a drop myself, but
Katrina doesn't drink alcohol.
No,
actually.
No.
It's a pretty high bar.
Yeah.
We'll put that to the test one day, though.
Okay. Yes. Next Comic-Con, I'll bring the whiskey. So the answer is out of bounds, outlandish.
Let's say outlandish.
Yeah. Outlandish.
Yeah.
All right.
Certainly are after a few whiskeys, anyway.
So I'm going to make a statement, and again, this season, Jamie and Roger have a huge altercation. Outlander, outlandish, or out of bounds?
I say out of bounds.
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 Spoilers.
From the trailer, we know that there may be other time travelers because of the skull with the silver fillings. We will meet these other time travelers this season. Ron, Outlander, outlandish, or out of bounds?
Outlander.
Ooh. He just dropped.
He just dropped a nugget. Yes. Okay. As we all know, Tobias Menzies, who we miss, will be playing the new Prince Philip on the hit Netflix show, The Crown. That's right. A crossover episode of Outlander and The Crown is currently in the works. Outlander, outlandish, or out of bounds?
Outlander.
I wish it was.
You wish it was. All right. Sam, last question for you. Rumor has it that you could be the next James Bond. Outlander, outlandish, or out of bounds?
Head is getting so big.
That's definitely out of bounds.
Out of bounds.
Da, 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 da.
Da, 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 da. Just call me Moneypenny.
Trading in that whiskey for a martini? Out of bounds. All right. Okay, let's open it up for the fan Q&A. We want to hear from you all in the audience. I can't see you, but I know you're out there. Oh. There we go.
Oh, nice. Ooh, they're pretty.
Whoa!
Wow. Hi.
Hello.
Oh, my God.
Hello.
Wow,
that's nice.
All right. We've got 6 minutes, people. Make it count. Wonder Woman, what you got to say?
I'm Rena from Virginia, and my question is, I know you get to wear lots of different costumes, kilts, dresses, bum rolls, all the fun things. What is your favorite outfit that you got to wear so far?
That's a good one. I know my favorite Katrina outfit.
It's so hard to decide. I actually really, really like the Claire Frontier look that we went with this season. There's like a cool velvet coat over a skirt and there's a leather belt and it's very, it just felt very strong and fierce.
I like that combination. Okay, over here.
Hi. My name is Madeline, I'm from Connecticut. This is for everybody. What would be the most important item that you would stitch into your dress before you up and leave your loved ones forever and time travel into the past?
Oh. All right, you want to start, Katrina?
Money.
Money. Sam?
Obviously, into my dress or my kilt, I would... something really... My hip flask.
Hip flask. Okay.
Yep.
Sophie?
I think I would take a modern toothbrush. Just because, you know, you don't need them falling out and stuff.
No.
I think I'd have to copy Claire's idea of taking the antibiotics back. I'd hate the idea of dying of a paper cut. Yeah. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. That's not the way to go.
No, it's just really...
I know, syphilis is a killer.
Wow.
And that was your public service announcement brought to you by Outlander. Ron, really quickly, you want to chime in?
Oh, penicillin all the way.
Penicillin all the way.
I'm going headache medicine and the best leg warmers money can buy.
Okay. And Diana?
I would probably take a disassembled microscope in pieces.
Hey.
Thank you. Hey,
I like it. All right, this side.
Hi, my name is Karishma. I'm from New Jersey.
Hi.
I just want to take a moment to say I love you guys. Everything about the series and the set and the books is just amazing. I've been reading the book since, I would say, 2002, when my English teacher handed it to me as a required reading in college, and it has been amazing to go on this journey with you, Diana.
Well, thanks to your teacher.
I know, yes. Professor Maniscalco, call out and shout out to you for that. So my question is a little heavy, and I'm sorry I'm bringing this crowd to that place right now, but... The theme in today's episode was very dark. We saw young Ian Murray describe essentially a non-consensual situation. Jamie's character, like obviously Sam, your character, Jamie has been through that. Claire was nearly put through that. I can't speak to Brianna or Richard's character yet, but how do you feel about what is happening in our country right now? And what do you want to say about it?
I'm going to try to remix that question really quickly because that is really heavy, but you can't ignore the headlines and you can't ignore what's happening in the world at large, but how does that impact the plot lines, the themes, and sort of the tone of the shows? Ron and Meryl, can you take that, please?
Well, you know, ultimately, the show is about these characters and about this story. We don't choose to look at it as a platform for political ideas on any side. But at the same time, you know, all of us live in the world. We all live in this culture, we all live in this society. We can't help but, you know, have what happens in the world inform what we do, and we try to sort of be cognizant of what's happening in the world, be cognizant of our audience and how they would think of these subjects. And we try to sort of talk about that through the show, but not really to sort of preach to the audience or really say, this is the point of view. But we try to, you know, we look at the world that we live in just like you do, and it can't help but sort of influence our work. And, you know, I take solace in, you know, something that Barack Obama said, which was that he said that, in his opinion, the arc of history bends towards progress. And I tend to take that point of view as well.
Thank you so much.
Okay, and oh goodness, this is the last question, so I know on this side, so make it a good one.
Okay, hi.
Hi.
I'm Mary Beth, and I'm from Charlotte, North Carolina.
Hi.
And I've met all of you, and I love you so much. I wanted to ask about the music. I love the beginning of every single season so far, how you change the music to fit actually where it is. Now, North Carolina, I was waiting to hear that fiddle, and I did. So how do you go about doing that? What's the research process, or what do you decide, and how did you mix in Ray Charles into that?
Well, Meryl plays the fiddle, so it was mostly... No.
Yes, I do.
Bear McCrary, who's our fantastic composer. You know, every season we turn to Bear and we say, you know, this is what this season is about, and we'd like the main title to kind of reflect that thematically, and we let him loose. And then he comes back with a composition that usually blows us away, and we talk, you know, in very general terms about maybe a little more here, a little less here.
We fiddle with it.
We fiddle with it. In the end, the Ray Charles thing came out of, it was in the script. The writers put in at the end the idea that we would do an instrumental version of America the Beautiful. And literally, we were sitting in the editing bay, and it just sort of, I think, I don't remember whose idea, but it was, it might have been my idea. And I said, you know, there's a great vocal, a Ray Charles version. Let's see if we can find that. And we just thought, well, this is an unexpected way to go out on the episode, and it's kind of a bold one, so let's just go for it. And, you know,
it
everybody
was great.
Kind of,
it would work.
Thank you.
Ron, really quickly, just. I want to triple confirm that there will indeed be a season 5 and 6. Is that correct?
That is a fact.
Yes.
Are we in it?
Well,
yeah,
someone's in it.
That yet.
CG's doing amazing things these days.
No one's safe. Have you started mapping out seasons 5 and 6, Meryl? What can we expect and which direction will we go?
Oh, absolutely.
I am not allowed to ask that question. That question is in my
I didn't hear the question. But we're already back in the writer's room. The writers are actually working, not as we speak. Hopefully they're on the weekend. But we are already working on season 5, so well underway.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Speaking of music, let's end on a high note and watch the trailer from season 4.
Do you know what lies beyond those trees? This is just the start of what America will become. People who come here in their thousands, all hoping to live the American dream.
Is that the same as our dream?
I suppose it is. Welcome to Riveron.
Thank you, Auntie.
North Carolina offers wealth and prosperity.
I don't agree with keeping people as property.
You're a lively one, you know.
We must leave.
Live on our own terms.
It's perfect.
If I can make this a good land, my presence here now can be felt by Oriana later. Then that would be something.
I'm Stephen Bonnet, sir.
Be wary. Travelers in these woods are set upon by thieves and outlaws.
There are savages here.
Oh, my God.
Shouldn't she know the truth?
Hello?
Diana.
I have some news about your mother.
Everything's in my power.
It's a silver filling, something that won't be invented for 100 years. This will lead us to fighting in another war. We will be on the wrong side of history again.
I can't change your world without you, Sassanac. A dream for some can be a nightmare for others.
Sometimes life takes unexpected turns.